We'd like to highlight that I'm presenting results and outcomes from work, from a research program that we worked on at CIVI for several years, and now I'm switching here position to the Stockholm Environment Institute. So, but the results are from our common work at CIVI. And in that, I just want to stress that when we came from sort of the water sector, it wasn't that evident how much water is actually consumed in power production like two, three years ago. Now we're beginning to get much better metrics, and as Ken Bruder said, there's still much work going on in that space. So we still need to do to understand that picture much better to get into those type of maps that Charles presented. So we looked at those fundamentals of water consumption, power production, the relationship at the regional level between power planning development and water resources. And there are a couple of case studies that are available on the Aral Sea Basin, on the efforts on Tigris, the economics of cooperation in hydropower, water, agriculture and ecosystems, and Nile Basin. And now the program is moving into actually understanding how this has played out in Scandinavia, water power trading, the role of hydropower and in support of renewable energy. So some four key findings that have come out from this exercise is that as we have heard, we clearly see that water is a central component to today's and tomorrow's energy mix. That sounds like a very, very natural statement, but as I said earlier, it hasn't translated right into the real policy discussions yet. We have worked with IEA for quite some time, very interesting, and even when you speak to the power sector, hydropower sector there, they don't really see water as a source of fuel always. The role of water resource management is something which is very, very important, and it has to come into that. We heard about the consumption forecast to grow by almost 50%, and it's also clear that most of that growth will happen in the OECD countries. And in the Nile Basin that we're talking about now, you only have about 3 to 10% access to modern electricity in the upstream riparian countries, and as much as 100% in Egypt. And what does that mean? It's a number that usually is played with like this, but if you look at a country like Rwanda, for example, that has maybe today 80 to 100 megawatts installed today, a capacity for 10 million people, and you have Sweden with 10 million people and about 35,000 megawatts installed. So we are talking about a fraction here, which translate into daily life. Daily life in terms of refrigeration, agriculture, and so forth. So this is a major concern for those upstream countries. And scarcity, as Charles presented, is increasing, and partly because we have to meet these demands. And this is very, very relevant in many parts of the Nile Basin. And I would argue, perhaps a little bit contrary to what Holger said, this basin is not really closed as a whole. Parts of the basin may be closed, sub-basins that are closed from a water resources perspective. But there is much one can do here to increase the efficiency in all aspects of utilizing water. So still, the argument is that these energy policies have been developed in isolation. And we even see that very clearly in Europe right now. There's a sort of a fitness check going on of the EU Water Framework Directive and all the water-related legislation in the EU. And even that process is not really taking into account the new energy directive and those processes. So in Europe, we also need to address this much, much more in common to see how these processes link, as we heard clearly also from the examples from EDF. So much more work to do in this area. Power planning tools, then, second outcome, needs to assess all available energy and water resources at the appropriate scale. The power planning processes so far has been very much project-oriented, and large-scale regional power planning work is not really done between many, many countries. But in the Nile Basin, it's been one excellent exemption from that, where there's been this sort of strategic sectoral environmentalist assessment upstream of all sources of fuel, which include then oil, coal, wind, solar, bioenergy, and hydropower in the upstream six countries, which has resulted in a power planning opportunity that considers water resources and social, economic, financial, and technical costs involved in that. And that program then has come back and related into a fairly good agenda of hydropower development and the development of geothermal too by the private sector. And there are examples from the bank here that can present the World Bank on, for example, the region Rusumo Falls hydropower project in Rwanda, Tanzania, and Burundi. So These type of pre-investment tools like the SSCA are very, very good to utilize in large-scale power planning. And they are upstream the type of leap and weep, the more detailed power plan tools that you have to do when you come down at the power, at the more feasibility study. But they are very useful in terms of involving stakeholders, in looking at options, in ideally in doing some sort of regional power planning exercises, which is exemplified in the Nile Basin. The third aspect of this is not only looking at, of course, the sources of fuel, the power potential in the basin, but it's also about looking at regional power market development and how that improves efficiency and reliability. And from us that have been working a lot in the transboundary water field, we have been talking a lot about sharing the benefits or water resource development rather perhaps than sharing always the water volumes to avoid allocations, but looking at how can you trade the benefits of good water use in a market, so for food, electricity, and so forth. And when it comes to the benefits of hydropower, it's clear, or any electricity development for that matter, it's one of those type of benefits that can actually be quite easily traded, and there are very good examples of that. So in the Nile Basin, the East African power pool is now developing quite rapidly, which is a market exchange idea between the five upstream countries. And the Nile Basin Initiative Power Trade Project has been promoting this now for almost 10 years to try to see the interlinkages also between the Renaissance Dam and exports of hydropower electrons to Egypt and even beyond. So these type of co-management of electricity networks is very, very important, especially in regions where you have very low accessibility, because they provide an opportunity to develop the resources where they are found, and then to share them in a market between the countries, if trust is built, which is, of course, a very, very important part of this. So also then, the cooperation on transboundary waters and of these solid investments into infrastructure, hydropower, for example, and into the power trade and markets, brings a very good rationale for wider expansion into other economic integration aspects. And this is one of the messages we have been looking at and working quite a lot at, that is to see how the regional economic communities globally can actually take up these, some of these transboundary water resources work and recognize that in different outcomes, like in hydropower and in water supply and in food security. So the African Union, the East African Community, and the Common Market for East and Southern Africa, they all address these type of aspects and are very, very relevant actors here in this space of developing water resources, sharing the benefits, and power market development. And it's not only in the Nile, we see the same thing in many other parts of the world, and hence also the interest of addressing this in, and understanding it better in the European context. Fourth type of key measure is sometimes a little bit controversial to talk about, but large-scale water storage has a key role to play in the water energy nexus from a regional perspective. And there's a latest report, I think a few copies left there on the table from CV, on that. Now, we also know that there's a tremendous large capacity within the Nile Basin, and Ethiopia has still 30,000 megawatts or so for development, Sudan 5,000 megawatts, Uganda 2,000 megawatts, which are on stream, which are run-of-the-river schemes that can be built in cascades. And this development is now taking place slowly, slowly. And we heard from Charles also that perhaps always not planned, as we, you know, from a textbook perspective would like to see it, but also sort of like to highlight that from this report we've gone through all the different policies that have been developed over time on how to do good large-scale hydropower and water storage development. And there are many of them. We have the World Bank safeguard policies, the World Commission on Dams, the Equator Principles that were developed for the private sector and the financing industry, UNEP Dams and Development Report, and the latest one is the IHA, International Hydropower Association's Sustainability Assessment Protocol. So today we have very, very good and relevant tools, and we have learned a lot about how to do good, solid water storage development. So it's a question of understanding these tools and utilizing them. And there are many, many examples of that, and I think the Rusumo Force one, which is now has gone through all this exercise. It took 5 years to do this upstream assessment, to do the detailed feasibility assessments, to look how it fits into the regional power grid, And it's an excellent example of how three countries then really can cooperate and create common sharing agreements between them on this specific issue.